Okay, so we guys are live on Facebook, sorry, on YouTube. So now we'll be discussing about mind maps. So I think I have Harsha's mind map here. I'll be sharing my screen so you guys can see. You guys are able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
So this is Harsha's mind map. So the purpose of a mind map is, yeah, Harsha.
Yeah, I would like just like to point out that all the first one is a complete rough. If you want the final version, you can check the doc file.
Okay, cool. So then I'll see somebody else's mind map. See this Arya's mind map. So basically, the purpose of a mind map is that I get conceptual clarity around the concepts which are introduced in the video which I'm watching or in the document which I'm reading. Yeah.
Yeah.
So now when I talk of conceptual clarity, there are two things. We'll go with Wittgenstein ka quote. He says, before philosophy, thoughts are cloudy and thoughts are indistinct. Okay. Now, he says, with the usage of philosophy, thoughts become clear and thoughts tend to have sharp boundaries. Now, fast and agile, are they synonyms? Fast and agile, are they synonyms?
No.
I hope I'm audible.
Yes, they are synonyms.
Are they the same?
No.
No.
Why?
Because agile is for like skill and fast is just about speed.
No, fast is about speed. Agile is about changing direction along with speed. Let's just see Google it. Ability to move quickly and easily. Method of project development used for software development that is characterized by division of tasks into short phases for frequent reassessment. That's what I told you yesterday, no? That in small chunks you do the project, you reassess, and then again you go forward. So agile, like dogs have agility competition, no?
Yeah.
Have you guys seen an agility competition of a dog?
Yes. It is a skill, right, sir?
Yeah, it is a skill, but you see, this is kind of agility where I have to be able to balance speed and direction.
Yeah.
Okay.
I should be able to change direction without losing speed.
Mm-hmm.
So they're similar ideas but different. So now do you understand what it means to define sharp boundaries for a concept?
Yes.
Yeah.
What does it mean?
So before the concept is clear, the difference between fast and agile wasn't clear. The boundary wasn't sharp. It was very foggy.
I need to know what it means, and sharp is I need to be able to define the boundaries, right? Now, to give it a sharp boundary, we're distinguishing between agile versus fast. We're doing to give it a sharp boundary, but to make it clear, what are we doing? We're writing three examples of agile. Can we give three examples of agile? Dog competition, dog in a competition, in an agility competition.
So is it like when you're driving and also you have to take a U-turn, so you have to manage the speed and the direction?
Yeah, Formula One racing, where they're supposed to take the turn in Formula One racing without losing speed. Then any other example of agile?
Hurdle racing.
Okay.
But that's just another race.
It's kind of similar to dog.
Yeah.
Is it? It's even nicer in kitchens, right? Like when you're in a restaurant, I mean, you cut really fast, but you know, be careful that you don't cut yourself and stuff like that.
Okay, you're saying cutting onion fast. You're able to change the path and you're also able to cut quickly. Okay. So by writing more examples for the same thing, we get clarity around it. And by contrasting it with very similar sort of words, by comparing with very similar kind of words, we get to understand the sharp boundaries. So this is what we're trying to do through our mind map. So now in this mind map, okay, shifting the focus. So one you're saying is shifting the focus to process. Okay, so these are the different threads which is covering. But in your mind map, you were also supposed to write examples for each, no? Arya, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
You were also supposed to write examples for each, no?
So examples for each, like for what? Abstract concepts, right?
Yeah, so this is not exactly done the way I wanted it to be done. So
okay.
Let's do it this way.
Oh, yeah.
So now I'll paste it in Paint.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Is it necessarily have to be a mind map to process all of this?
No, mind map is just one of the tools.
Okay.
It's just one of the tools. And we're trying to master this tool for now. Okay. So now you guys can see the screen, right?
Yeah.
So now she said, he's shifting the focus to process. Why did cognitive grammar come in here, Arya?
So, Dr. Ramanjan, when he was talking about pattern, he was talking about breaking the steps and thinking what's happening in the brain. And that's why I added cognitive grammar over there. When he was talking about
pattern. Okay. Yeah, so you see you're putting abstract words, no? Like drawing connections. Can we write examples for this?
Like I've written connection between math and science, you know, physics and all.
Okay, use a different color pen for the example.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So that it's clear for you, no? So this is an example. Connection between math and science. Can we think of one more example?
You can connect math to various things.
But even when you say connecting math with science, it's abstract. Ho gaya. That's still not a clear example. Can we look at a clear example of what he means by connecting?
So do you mean like when we're doing physics and then we do numerical math, is that a connection?
When you say connecting maths and science, it is vague. What do you mean by connecting maths and science?
Like you need, when you're doing science and you're doing science but at a higher level, you need.
This is what is faffing. You're only hand waving on top, but it's not a concrete example. What would be a concrete example?
Tarun, can I?
Yeah.
So, if you're using, like, if you're calculating accuracy and precision, then we are using multiplication and maths formulas. So, I guess that's the link.
Correct. So, let's say you're trying to measure, as Rupali said, you're trying to measure speed and precision of a rocket. So, you're involving mathematics in physics. So there is physics involved because you want to study how the rocket moves. There is mathematics involved because there are some equations to be solved. You can make it more concrete by exactly explaining which equation, right? Or to look at it in a simple way, let's say, I mean, if you have to look at it in a fifth class level, you're trying to understand how a horse runs, right? When how a horse runs on a hilly terrain and how a horse runs on a plateau. Two different kinds of places, how does a horse run? So there is math involved because you're using distance by speed. For fifth class, that is the math. There is science involved because you're trying to see how the horse changes its speed as per the terrain. Why does the horse go slower on softer tracks? Why does the horse go faster on harder tracks? So there is science involved because you're trying to study. Yeah.
I was supposed to give like real specific examples. I will keep that in mind. So like they're calculating distances and deriving derivations of gravitational force or something like that. I have to write that specifically.
You have to be as specific as you can. And it is not because I am asking you. It is the process which we've got to follow in our mind. Why should we be as specific as we can when we think of an example? Rupali, why should we be as specific as possible?
Because it makes it more...
Because it gives boundaries.
Because we otherwise have an illusion of understanding. When you say connecting maths and science, you'll feel you understood. But only when you actually try to think of examples, that's a litmus test. Like let's say you have a... I mean, why do you have a diagnostic test for different things? Because you want to know for sure whether you know or whether that's true or not true, correct? So that's how you have a litmus test. That is, you know you've understood the concept if you're able to come up with three very specific and concrete examples for it. Okay, now he says there are different kinds of interactions in a classroom. Student and student interaction, student and teacher interaction. So can we give some concrete examples of student and student interaction?
So for example, when they have a group project, they have to... When they have a group project,
like student solving.
Yeah, Rupali, go ahead. Rupali, go ahead. You guys have to be faster, yaar. We're recording this. I don't want it to be too slack. When you actually listen to this, I want this to be more
copying somebody, another student's work.
Okay, one way of student interaction is copying. Okay. Can you give one more example?
When a student...
Copying between students.
Copying... is one interaction.
When a student is trying to explain his friend what the teacher like, if person has not understood, when they're trying to explain it.
What? Give a concrete example. And what is a student explaining?
Group discussions.
No, give a concrete example. These are all abstract. Explain. Group discussion is abstract. Tell a proper story. Concrete. Explain. What is a student explaining?
So if my friend has not understood the concept of multiplication, I am trying to explain my friend that
multiplication is abstract. Let us say the student is explaining Kattappa. Why did Kattappa kill Bahubali? Is this easier to visualize?
Yeah.
Or student yes. Explaining multiplication is easier to visualize. So I need to understand what I mean. I mean, student and student interaction appears very easy because the words are familiar. But what does the professor mean by student and student interaction? That is, in a classroom, students talk to each other, students probably copy from each other. What else happens?
Very debate.
So a student might debate about, like, when Dr. Ramanujaman was talking about, does root 2 exist? Someone might say, some student might say it does not exist and it's irrational. And the other might say it's irrational.
Correct. Students might debate on what an answer is. Let us say, I say x square equal to 4. The student might debate of whether 2 is the only answer or whether other answers. Somebody might say, okay, minus 2 is also an answer. They may pick up something to debate. Okay. Now, counterexample. Counterexample is looking to prove something wrong. Can we have examples of counterexample? Let's say I say that women cannot do proper work.
We will give the examples of people who are accomplished.
That is abstract. Concrete banao na bhai.
Sarojini.
Okay, Sarojini Naidu. Mary Curie. Okay. Okay. Now this is for counterexample to counter that women cannot work. Can you think of any other counterexample for some other situation?
Somebody might say the earth is flat.
Yeah, but and if you say earth is flat, what is
the counterexample might be showing the path of the sun and the stars.
There's a difference between counter argument and counter example.
Yeah.
Now, do you guys realize why it is so important to list examples?
Right.
Can we please avoid this disturbance in the background, wherever that's coming from? Yeah. So, see, you know why examples are important? Writing examples and discussing the examples.
So that we could get a proper idea. The boundaries are sharper.
Exactly. Right now you confuse counterexample with counter argument. Counterexample is only like I'm claiming a principle over a set of things. I'm saying that this thing is true for a set of things. Now within those set of things, I find out one thing for which the principle is wrong. Like when I say women are not capable of working, that principle is operating only over women. So you produce the example of one woman who is able to work and that whole statement falls apart. The statement looks like all X are A. The statement looks like all X are A. So if I can produce one X, which is not A, the whole principle is gone.
Hmm.
Did you understand what I said?
Yes.
Yeah.
What did I say? All counterexample is like
all X are A.
We can and produce
proof
one X, which is A, which is not A.
Which is not A, then the counterexample.
Like, let's see a concrete example of this cognitive grammar. All women, women cannot do good work. Then you produce, so what is X here? Women. What is A here?
Good work.
So B is one X, say Y is one value of X, which is not A. So what is Y here?
Sarojini Naidu.
A, why does A, yes. Got it? The grammar here?
Yes.
Can we think of one more example for this? For counterexample? So Sarojini Naidu is counterexample. Why is the counterexample? Can you give me one more principle?
All healthy food is not tasty.
Yeah. Healthy food is not tasty. What is X?
Healthy food.
What is A? Not
tasty. Not tasty.
What is why?
Why can be fruits or someone likes some nice fruit or vegetable, they can say that. Or, you know, specifically like apple. I like apple. Apple is healthy and apple is tasty for me.
Yeah. So why satisfies A? No. That is apple is tasty. So apple is counter example. Here Sarojini Naidu is counter example. Okay. So in this mind map, what we're doing is, for counter example, we're coming up with like Sarojini Naidu. What was the other counter example we said?
Apple.
Apple. Can you give me one more example of counter example?
All bags are heavy.
All?
Bags are heavy.
Bat. Bags.
Bag.
All bags are heavy. So what is X? Bag. What is A? Heavy. So what is Y now?
Heavy. An empty bag is not heavy?
Empty bag.
Okay. Y satisfies A? No. So empty bag is counter example. So when I write these words, why should I come up with concrete examples like this? Now, do we understand counter example better? Do we feel more comfortable and confident?
Yes.
Yeah.
So if I were to draw a mind map, I would say, education moving from content to process. This is the overall objective. Now the mini objective is counter example. Now for this I'll come out with three examples. What are the three examples which I said? Apple is healthy. That counters that all healthy foods need not be boring. Yeah, what was the other one?
Sarojini Naidu is
a woman, comma, good work.
Good work. And empty bags are not heavy.
Counter example does not mean this is the only counter example. I just need one such example to prove that thing wrong. Yeah. What was the other counter example?
Empty bags are not heavy.
Now, just by seeing the mind map, we may not understand all of it. That is okay. Right? That is why we... Right? So, what is counter example? Using one example to prove a statement wrong. This is a process that in mathematics we use the method of counter example also sometimes to prove something wrong. Okay, now what can someone else tell me in this lecture one other principle which you learned? One is one process which you learned is counter example. What other process you learned?
Open-ended questions are better because they allow discussion.
Whoa.
Open-ended questions. Now for open-ended questions, now what is the boundary for counter example? Thank you.
the boundary is that there is one example that proves there are more than one or one at least one
example. Counter example. Only when the sentence is like all x are y.
Okay.
When the statement talks of a huge collection, then I use one example to prove that it is not true for everyone. If a statement is like everybody in the school is naughty, I take one example to prove that somebody is not naughty. I mean, everyone is not naughty because I give one example. But if the statement is like the students of this school may be naughty, can I use a counter example for that?
No.
That statement can never be proven wrong. Because that statement is not saying they are naughty. It's only saying they may be naughty.
May be naughty.
So counter example cannot be used there.
Yeah.
Now open-ended questions. What is a boundary? Open-ended questions. He's talking of open-ended questions only for the sake of allowing discussions. So is he saying that in the exams all questions should be removed and only open-ended questions should be allowed?
No.
Now do you realize some people complain that they're quoted out of context? You understand what I'm saying?
No.
I might go on a stage and I might say, let us use more open-ended questions to allow discussions. Somebody might say,
yeah,
Tarun said that in exams we should not use these questions, we should use only open-ended questions. It's
yeah.
a false deduction, no?
Yeah.
So my statement applies only in a boundary. Only to allow a discussion, I'm using open-ended discussions, but I might still need those questions with one correct answer. Yeah, so can we give examples of open-ended questions?
There are aliens, because some might say there are aliens in the world, like we're not the only.
Okay.
So because you can argue that it's true, it's not, because it's not been proven.
Aliens. Okay. Can we ask more academic questions so one can see that open-ended questions can also come in the syllabus context, in the context of maths or English? Let's say, what would you prefer, 5 chocolates or 2 cakes? Let's say I'm teaching fractions and there I want them to look at, you know, not just the numerator but also the denominator. So I say it's not just the quantity but also the size which matters. Not just the number but the size which matters. So I ask, what would you prefer, 5 chocolates or 2 cakes? It's an opinion and question. English, can we ask a question which is open-ended?
Like,
what kind of verbs are better?
No, that is abstract. Can we ask a more, like when you say 5 chocolates or 2 cakes, it's very concrete.
Like, is it like a fast and agile kind of example, you mean?
Yeah. But it should be very concrete, very relatable. Yeah, are fast and agile same? Let's say, are cheetah, let's do one thing, most agile. Cheetah agile. Okay. Second, fast or agile? No, this is not exactly open-ended.
Do you want a smart friend or an intelligent friend?
Good one. Smart friend or intelligent friend? Good one. Can you give me one open-ended question from social studies context?
What makes a person good? What makes a person do good or bad actions?
Can you think of a more interesting question?
So what kind of answers do social studies questions supposed to have?
Like, why did First World War happen?
Let's look at fifth class level, no?
Okay.
What are the few topics that fifth class level have?
Kingdoms and all.
Like,
what is democracy?
Do you think democracy is a good form of government?
I don't understand democracy by then. Which army is better? Horses or swordsmen?
So do they like get the answer from looking at history?
No, I mean, you ask these open-ended questions and you connect it with the king, right? Let's say the king had very good cavalry.
Yeah.
Then you ask this open-ended question and you connect it with cavalry and why people had good cavalry. So when you ask them, is cavalry better or infantry better? They'll tell you cavalry can move faster. Cavalry can attack and run away. And cavalry is at a height. So mm-hmm. They have an advantage of height also. They have an advantage of height and speed.
Yeah.
But infantry are cheaper. You can have more infantry.
Yeah.
So there'll be more perspective. So then they'll appreciate what is written. If the textbook says that he had a great cavalry and he had some infantry, they just read it, but without an appreciation of what that means.
Yeah.
But when you ask an open-ended question like this, when they form an opinion over cavalry and infantry, they understand, why should I care about cavalry and infantry?
Yeah.
Like Harsha was telling me that, you know, he learned more from computer games than from school. I wouldn't be surprised, because I learned a lot of strategy and micromanagement while playing Age of Empires game.
Mm-hmm.
Now don't tell your parents all this and start playing computer games. Yeah, any other thing which you guys saw
in
the lecture?
One more thing that I observed was Dr. Ramanujan talked about how generalization helps in math.
Okay, let's keep that for a while. It may be a little technical. Can we look at one more?
Oh, formal communication.
Okay, does he explore it more? Can we pick those things which he explores and explains more?
Yeah.
Math curriculum should be logical and pedagogical.
Okay. So pedagogy of mathematics, let us say. Now, do you guys understand what am I writing in orange?
The boundary, right? No.
No, boundary is red.
The meaning of the concept.
Okay. So the curriculum development has to involve both pedagogy and content perspectives. Yeah. Can you give one example of how a way of teaching can make some concept easy to understand? Let's say fractions with clay activity. okay, history with role play. So these are activities. Then you can do vocabulary. Context assessment, as in are they using the words in the proper context or not. You can assess it so that you can help them in using words in the right place. So pedagogy is the existing content. How do you teach it in a way that the kid gets it? Okay.
Yeah.
Now pedagogy plus content, right? Now, what is content? Content is the philosophy and subject depth. Okay. So, for fractions, what will be the content?
The concept of dividing things.
Concept of dividing things is division. Labels for part of a whole. Labels for part of a whole.
Okay.
Okay. Here it might be army and strategy, let's say. I want to explain that. Here, let's say fast versus agile. Which words and corresponding situation, like agile and fast. Like horses, swordsman, like 1/2 cake. Yeah. So now I want an observation of the mind map. So can we see a mind map coming here? By the way, I never made a mind map like this. This is the first time I'm making a mind map like this. So you have different structures. Oops.
A very beautiful mind map.
Yeah. Now, why did I use different color for each?
Because when we are observing it, we can differentiate it easily.
We could access the whole mind map easily.
Exactly. So now, why do we make this mind map? What are we doing? What are the processes we are doing while making this mind map?
We first point out the main principles and concepts.
First, this is a subpart of the whole lecture. In that subpart, we are writing, this is one main part. In that, we are writing a subpart. For each each principle like this, then what do?
We give examples. No, first, we define it.
First, we define the...
Not define exactly, but we write down in our own language, we translate it.
Yeah, and we define the boundary.
Yeah, no, you don't define the boundary. You first just translate it. Yellow is the definition. Yellow is you define it. Open-ended questions, counterexample and all. What is orange? What is orange?
the translation.
Why do I write a translation?
It's to translate from the it's de-jargonizing.
Correct. But just with translation, I may not understand because the translation is still abstract. All these three are abstract. The yellow, orange, and red are all warm colors. All these warm colors are abstract. The cool color is concrete. Yeah. So when I see more examples, I appreciate the abstract thing better. What observations did you guys make while we were doing this? Come on, quick. Observations which you made. Reflections are very important. You're an active learner only if you're able to reflect while you're doing something.
That the similar examples are used throughout the mind map. Like in the open-ended questions part, the cakes example and the calligraphy example is used, while in the pedagogy, the same examples are used.
Go ahead.
It helps to connect the two things in a greater way.
Correct, and it also helps me in being lazy. I need not think of too many examples. Good. No,
one more thing.
I don't need to think of too many examples, and it also helps me in understanding better. In many places, lazy is actually nice, you know.
Yeah.
Are you guys getting what I'm saying? Lazy is actually nice. I don't have to do too much work, but I can use the same thing in two places to also understand it better. It's not hard work, but smart work here. You know, same example, use it. Yeah. Someone was saying something. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was saying that we need to be very, very precise while giving the examples.
What do you mean by very precise?
Means that when I said, for example, when I gave that we need to relate math and science, there was a little abstract still. We need to be very precise. I don't know who pointed it out, but you said about the horse and the running, you know, so we can calculate the distance and...
Yeah, so it should be easy to visualize, because the more complicated things we use, we don't process them that easily. But easy to visualize things, we process them a lot faster in our brain. Okay, what are the observations you made? Examples should be more concrete. We can reuse our examples and then...
Like, one more. Yeah, you can continue.
Yeah, so you there's like a clear flow of thought.
Okay, like?
Like you know what the next step in thinking is. Like first it is the definition and then translation. And then like if you do it in any other way... I mean, I think you're learning just...
You can do it in another way, but you'll deal with a lot of chaos and uncertainty.
Yeah, your learning becomes unclear, yeah.
Correct. So the structure is bringing a flow of thought. You know what to do next. Then?
One more thing. Using colors is really important because it helps you differentiate and makes it easy to understand.
Using colors for differentiation. Okay, then? What else did you observe? And how are we writing the boundaries? How are we identifying the boundaries?
By putting this
Shweta, how are we defining the boundaries?
From counterexamples.
No, how did we define the boundary for open-ended question for curriculum development, that is pedagogy plus content?
See with on which particular situation these principles are used.
Are you speaking?
And maybe later on you can also include the why, the reason why the principle is true, and that would be the intent. If I want to make sense of any content, I need to look at the intent and the context. Intent is the intention. Why that is important.
Arun, you were not audible.
Yeah, I'm saying that later on, maybe if you want, you can include the reason also. Why should you go for it? The intention, sometimes intention can be the context. But yeah, content makes sense with context and content makes sense with intent. There's an intention for the content. There's an intention over why something is being said.
Examples.
Yeah. So context and intent both can go over the boundary basically, maybe. Yeah. Any other observations or we'll close the video? Any other observations quick? Rupali, any observations over what we discussed?
No, not particular.
Shweta?
I'm still.
Sorry?
I'm thinking.
Okay, I need you all to tell me one observation now in 2 minutes. Harsha?
Yeah.
So everybody's looking at each other. Yeah, who's going first? Whoever goes last has to give me 2 observations. Or you get an imposition 20 times. One observation.
My mind maps overall help in make.
Overall help in?
Seeing the whole thing structure, the whole structure of thinking in a visual way.
Okay, structure in a visual way. Okay, any other observation?
So I think when you're writing examples, I think during writing examples also you're defining boundaries.
How?
Because like remember when we thought of cheetah and that we thought it doesn't make sense.
Correct. Examples also clarify boundaries. Because we are checking if example suits the situation or not. Good point. Then? Good observation. Then? Rupali and Arya are left. Yeah, Harsha, go ahead.
No.
Yeah, who's going next? Rupali and Arya are left.
Okay, so we have written education moving from content to process in the middle so that we know what we are talking about, and then the yellow part that is open-ended question, that is the principle, and just around it the definition, and that is applied to a certain boundary, and the examples of it are in blue so that it can be understood.
So what you said is basically combination of observation 3 and observation 4. There's a flow to the thinking and we are color coding various stages. Yeah. No, Arya is left.
Okay. Okay, so the mind maps, when we were making mind maps, we actually are questioning ourselves. So it's a way of questioning, questioning helps us to understand if we have a concept truly or not. Similarly, mind map is also a way to understand the the fundamentals of the video or the content.
See, I would like to put it this way. I'd like to put it this way ki there are four very important elements to look at, and that four elements better be done in a certain flow. So what the mind map does is the mind map brings in a certain thinking discipline. Do you guys understand what I mean by thinking discipline? While I'm thinking, I can go in random ways. But when I bring a certain discipline to my thinking, I can actually get a lot of clarity around what I'm doing. So it'll make sure that I pay attention to those things which matter.
Like having a structure.
Yeah, that's what the structure is doing. Yeah. Pay attention to things which matter. What are the things which matter? Examples, boundaries, and having a translation or an interpretation.
In all learning situations, are these the only things?
You're trying to explain it to someone else. You're trying to say that only, right? When you're trying to explain to someone else, clear about your own thoughts and where is
no
what,
it's not like, about someone else, it's about with yourself. I mean, I'm saying you're interacting with your ideas, you're interacting with your content, you're interacting with your content. I have a content called counterexample, but now I'm actually interacting with the concept of counterexample a lot better. Imagine counterexample was a person and I'm talking to counterexample. With the color coding and with the structure, I'm able to understand counterexample better. I have a profile, no, for counterexample. What is the profile of counterexample? I look at the boundaries of counterexample. I look at the translation of counterexample, and I look at examples of counterexample. So for every idea, I have a profile. Right? I am profiling my ideas. You understand what I mean by profiling ideas, no?
Yeah.
You're writing a profile for every idea. So through the profile, you understand the idea. Like how for a person, you write a profile. No, when you read a person's profile, you know what that person is. Yeah, Rupali, you were saying something.
No, I was saying that in context to all of this from the past days, what we are discussing is understanding and the illusion of understanding. So it sums up that also.
Correct. You come out of illusion of understanding because it forces you to think. And it's a kind of self-assessment. Do I really understand? Self-assessment or litmus test. Do I really understand? Are you guys getting what I'm saying? What do you mean by self-assessment or litmus test?
So that we don't fall trap into the emotional or biased understandings.
Okay. Rupali, what do you mean by self-assessment or litmus test?
Like that, going back to instincts.
What do you mean by going back to instincts?
Like just recalling what I actually know. And I think that I know this, but I have not gone to the depth of it.
Okay. That is, you know, instead of using the concept, I end up going back to what I already know before.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other observations? So as I said, mind map is to enforce thinking discipline. So when I say enforce thinking discipline, it's so easy to get carried away, okay? But it's important that we do it with great discipline. Why do I say it's important that we do it with great discipline?
Because it helps us to pay attention that really matter.
No, I mean, you may do it, but in all likelihood, you may skip one or two elements and then do it. Are you guys getting what I'm saying?
No. What do you mean by elements?
I mean, what if someone does it by skipping the boundaries and say, I'll only write the example?
Oh, okay.
So it has to be implemented with full discipline. And how do you implement it with full discipline? How do you ensure you're implementing with full discipline?
To remember the whole flow.
No, have a mind map shepherd.
But
what if I have a mind map shepherd? Have a friend or have a colleague or someone who'll always have a look at your mind maps and check whether you're following the structure or not. Have a good shepherd. The shepherd herds the sheep, no?
Yeah.
So have a good mind map shepherd. Did you guys understand what I mean by have a good mind map shepherd?
Yes.
Yes.
What?
It's a person who makes sure that you're not missing any elements in your mind map.
Yeah, and you're actually implementing it in full spirit. So you better have a shepherd like the Dangal movie mein the coach. Very tough.
Yeah.
That's when you invoke the discipline. And once you invoke the discipline, when you're clear with mind mapping, it's like this, no? Chess ka grandmasters don't need a board. They can close their eyes and see the board. Did you guys get what I say?
Yeah.
No, I didn't get it.
Chess grandmaster doesn't need a board.
Okay,
so eventually when you're good with mind maps, what will happen is you can close your eyes and see mind maps.
Cool.
That's the practice level you'll be going. You'll be walking with conceptual clarity. So enough incentive for you to implement it with discipline. Is it enough of an incentive for you to implement it with discipline?
Yes.
Yes.
Why do you say enough of an incentive? All of you, one sentence and we close.
Because it provides a clear structure to learn.
Okay, and then?
That's lousy.
Because I know if I've actually understood that concept or not, or if I just think that I've understood the concept.
Okay, do you have the illusion of understanding? Sweta says I get a structure for thinking. Then?
Whenever I read a lot, there is a fog which is created in my mind. Like, I'm not very clear of what I actually understood or not. But if I practice mind maps more, then I'm very clear about what I have learned.
Right. And then?
Then I'll practice it more and then apply the execution part.
Yeah,
it's like executing your thing. Harsha, go ahead.
Yeah.
It creates a very, like she said, a structure to the thing, structure to